In this video, we're going to talk about scoped values within Java. JEP464, right over here, is what documents the current state of the scoped values preview feature as of JDK 22. Scoped values are in their second preview, where the first preview was in JDK 21, and then they were incubated in JDK 20. This is a good read if you want to know a little bit more about how the feature works. At a high level, what you can think of is that this is a replacement of ThreadLocal in some certain situations. And in the video here, I'll go over the difference between what a ThreadLocal can give you versus what the new scoped values give you. At a high level, the important thing to note is that you can't entirely replace ThreadLocals over here because they do have some other use cases that a scoped value can inherently not fix. But at least in my opinion, if you're using ThreadLocals for some of those other reasons, you might want to ask yourself why you are doing that. Without further ado, let's get into it. All right, to get into this, let's start with looking at ThreadLocal, because ThreadLocal came with JDK 1.2, and it is what we've been working with for years. And a scoped value is essentially going to replace portions of ThreadLocal for us. So let's review what a ThreadLocal can do. I do have JDK 22 preview features on. That's why I'm using the shorthand of the main method here. And one thing I did forget to do is I really should be calling this a private static final field. And the reason I'm doing that is because typically when you declare a thread local, you want to make sure that the thread local object reference is static and final and usually private for reasons I'll get into here in a second. Basically what this object reference allows you to do is each time that a different thread calls the object reference handle, it can have a different value associated with it. So what this code is doing here is we're creating an executor service with 5 threads in it, and then we submit each of the tasks, and then we are setting the value of our thread local to the name of the thread in which it is getting executed, and then we print it out. Normally, if we'd be running highly concurrent applications, this would be non-deterministic as far as what would print out, because you would have different threads going in here changing the state of a shared object reference, and then who knows what values you're going to get out of the object reference when you actually get them back. You might think you could throw in something like a synchronize statement, but in the case of thread local, that's completely unnecessary because a thread local is going to create the associated value that's in the generic here. It's going to have one of these for every single thread that calls into the thread local. So what we'll see is if we run this code, what we do get is we get every single thread called out. So pool one, because this is a fixed thread pool. And then I've got threads 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, all in different orders here. I could run this as many times as I want to, and the orders might change around, but there's never going to be a situation, if thread local is implemented properly, where I would have thread 2, for example, printed here twice. I'll just go ahead and run it a few more times just to prove that really quick. So this time the orders changed slightly, and this time they were almost exactly in the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 order. I think you get the point. A thread local is going to be unique per thread that calls on the object reference. Now, there are 3 problems called out in JEP464 as far as motivations for why we want to move on from thread local. The first one is that when I'm looking at a thread local, there is unconstrained mutability, meaning that when I have a set value up here and then I later on and get it, there's nothing preventing me within the same thread of doing another set later on. And that could get confusing for when you're writing code, because you would think after you set it once that you get it and you'd be able to get it for that same value in the thread that you set it in. The ability of the API to do this is nice from the context of flexibility, but it hurts the ability to read the code effectively when you're looking at a pretty large code base. The second problem has to do with what's called an unbounded lifetime. So think about if you have 10 different threads all executing and they are sharing a thread local. When you're done with thread 1, normally what you would do is you'd call the remove method on the thread local's local value for thread 1 so that it can be garbage collected. Because let's say that the object within the thread local generic is expensive to create. If you don't do that, you risk a leak because the thread local object reference is going to hang around until all of the threads are done with it. Or even worse cases, you have something like a thread pool, where you forget to release the resources when you're done with them, and then now that same thread goes back into the thread pool, and then some other client then goes and sends a request in and grabs that thread, and oh, the thread local value is already set. Let me go ahead and use that. Ugh, not good. And the third main problem called out is expensive inheritance. And that is when you have a thread local and you want to create what's called a child thread, meaning you spawn a thread off of a parent thread. What you'd have to do is you have to essentially create a whole copy of the thread local, and you have to bind the values, and that can get really expensive, again, when you have a situation where you've got an expensive object you need to construct. So now, let's look at a scoped value and see how that addresses some of the problems with ThreadLocal. If you're looking to migrate some existing code from ThreadLocal into scoped value, the first thing you have to do is, instead of instantiating a ThreadLocal, you want to instantiate a scoped value. And then we need to call scopedValue.newInstance, like this. Now let's call this scopedValue instead. And you'll notice there's not a set method here. And that's because scoped values don't have setters and getters in the sense of unconstrained mutability, where I can set the value wherever I want in the current thread. Instead, I have a scope associated with it. Think of a scope similar to a scope block, such as this try with resources right here. We've got this scope block here, and similarly, this for loop has a scope block, and so does this lambda expression. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna create another scope block. So to do that, we're gonna call scopedValue.where. What this does is it creates a binding where now our scoped value that we pass in now is going to have a value associated with it for as long as the scope of the where method is present. So let's give it a value that we had in this set method, like so. And then now that I have a binding, now I'm going to do something with the binding, and I'm going to run a lambda expression. So let's make a lambda expression. All right, and now this is my scope. So I could do something like this. And I don't need this anymore. All right, so now what'll happen is anytime I am within this lambda expression and I get the value of the scoped value variable, the get method here is gonna return whatever it was bound to up here. And this is great now because now I have a really clear relationship of where I set the value versus of where I'm getting it. One of the main use cases of thread local, besides what I showed earlier, is when you don't want to have to pass an object reference within a whole bunch of chained method parameters. So let's say that you've got a call stack which is 20 methods deep. Why should I have to pass in a parameter that 19 of those methods don't care about? The parameter list gets unwieldy very quickly. But I still want to make it thread safe, and I've got a class that I don't want to have this global variable for, then now I have to protect against all these different threads. So in the case of a scoped value, I know that when I am bounding the scope here, no matter how many calls this goes deep into the call stack, whether in this case it's none or whether it's 30, just to demonstrate that the nominal case is working as expected, we get the same type of output here. Now, let's go ahead and make this a little more interesting. And let's say that I'm gonna call a method in here. I'm just gonna call it method two. Then now I need to make method two. You'll see that I am not passing in any parameters to method two, but I do have access to the scoped value. So now within here, I'm gonna do scoped value.get. Nope, it looks like this is telling me I could probably make this a method reference. I'm gonna leave it as is for now. So we can see that we have the same output here. So this is where scoped values and thread locals are pretty similar in that within the call stack, I can ensure that I don't need to pass around all these unnecessary parameters, but I can still handle a class in a multi-threaded fashion. Awesome. But what I get from a scoped value that I don't get from a thread local is I get a very clear understanding of where the sets and gets are happening. So for example, the set here is determined by this binding here in the where method, and the get happens down lower in the call stack, so it's really, really clear. But you might be asking yourself, okay, well, what if I want to set something when I already have a binding set, aka I want to do a rebinding? Well, you can do that too. So to do a rebinding within an already bound scope, you just call scopedValue.where again, and then you can say scopedValue, and then you can say inner block. And then I will do the same thing, and then I'll make a lambda expression. And then I will do scopedValue.get. Let's go ahead and see what this looks like. All right, so here we're printing out all of the names, and then we call inner block here. Now, if this were a thread local, if I were to move this down like so, and I essentially did another set here, and I forgot to set it back to the value that I wanted to at the end of the time that I was done with it, then both of these gets would return inner block, because I'm effectively doing a set, then another set, then a get, and then a get. And I would have to be careful to set this back when I'm done with it. Again, let's say I throw an exception, literally anything that could cause me to need to call the set again, I would need to handle all those cases, but the scope will take care of it for me instead. Now let's run it again. And I get inner block 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 times, and I get each of the thread names printed out. Sweet. So again, that is really nice. Scoped values give you constrained mutability, where you can add as many nested rebindings as you want to, but it's very clear when the bindings are complete and what the scope of each binding is. So if I want to do some sort of conditional binding or anything like that, that's easy. If I want to make sure that the code that needs to be within that new binding is included versus not, that's easy too. One other thing related to this is that, let's say I had multiple scoped values, I can chain multiple wares together. So let's say I've got scoped value 2, hypothetically, and then I could say another value. I don't currently have another scoped value object reference defined, but let's say that I had multiple thread locals. I would have to have a set method for each thread local in here. And again, error prone, right? I don't want to have to remember each time to do that. Oh, and by the way, I need to reset it when I'm done with it. Versus in here, I can manage it all is one chained set of method calls, and it's really easy to remember. So actually, one of the things that a scoped value cannot fix is, let's say that you've got some code that relies on unconstrained mutability. You've got all sorts of set and get methods on a thread local all throughout the code within the logic chain, and moving that over into a scoped value just doesn't make sense. Well, in that case, you're probably stuck with a thread local. Sorry. Really, you should be asking yourself, why do you have to do that? Why can't you bind the scope of your set methods to something that is set, and your get methods are going to rely on essentially a one-way transmission of information? You're going to set something up here, and then you're going to get it down here. Why do you have to reset it all the time when you could just have a scope-bound set of code that has a known binding to a variable? Now, the second issue I called out with thread local was unbounded lifetimes. We can see here that the lifetime of a scope binding is really clear. It is literally defined by the scope of the run method here. Or let's say I wanted to combine run and where together, I could do a run where and do this all succinctly. That's another way to do it. And scope is great, right? It's very clear where things are in scope and out of scope. And it makes the compiler able to also enforce a lot of stuff for us, and the JVM can also enforce stuff in that it can do garbage collection when it no longer has access to something within scope. Think of a use case in older versions of Java where you had to do thread locals and you maintained a thread pool. You'd basically need to make sure that your pool doesn't have any sort of old data in it. It's just generally something that's not particularly safe, that is error prone and relies on the developer to get something right, which we as developers are error prone, right? And then over here, with more modern versions of Java, you can use a virtual thread rather than a thread pool in order to ensure that you don't have stale data going back into the pool. And then you can also use these scoped values to basically make sure that you are never doing something where the state of your thread local value is not what you would expect. You always have it scoped within the binding called out within your code. Which brings me to the last point, and that is expensive inheritance for thread local. In the case of scoped value, there's a special thing you can do when you use structured concurrency with the structured task scopes class, where you can allow a child thread that was created via those means to inherit the value of a scoped value binding. Let's take a look at what that code looks like. All right, so now we've changed this code up quite a bit. We still have the same scoped value here. Instead of using an executor service from JDK 5, we are using the structured concurrency structured task scope, which allows us to fork different tasks in such a way that we can ensure that there is structure around how we handle concurrent access to different things. And then what we're doing is we're calling the start and end methods here, where the end method here just returns the binding of the scoped value where the structured task scope was kicked off from. Whereas the start method creates an instance of this string container class, which literally just has this data field within it. And the only reason I'm doing this here is because lambda expressions require that the object references that they reference are either final or effectively final. So I can't change the data string directly in here. I have to give it a final container within it, and then I can modify the data member inside of it. So that's what I'm doing here. Effectively, what I'm doing is I'm creating a new scoped value binding, and then I am restricting it to just within the context of the start method here within the child thread, and then I'm returning it. So what this is showing is that within our main method, we have a scoped value binding. So the main thread, which is an OS thread, has the scoped value binding specified here. And then we're going to create two different virtual threads as part of the structured task scope here with the structured concurrency feature. And then what we're going to see is that we're going to be able to inherit the scoped value into both start and end, but we're going to rebind it in start. And then when we print out the value here using this string template, we're going to see that accordingly. And there we go. Within the start method, we have the in start. And then when we hit end, we get the original binding. The original binding was set right here. And then the in start version was set within the start method. So what this is showing is that similar to ThreadLocal, when you have a scoped value, if you want a child thread to inherit the current binding of the parent thread, you can use structure concurrency to do that, just like we did right here. Now, you might be wondering, what happens if I access a scoped value outside of a defined binding? Let's go ahead and find out. Let's print out scoped value.get, and we can see that I'm outside of the where clause because the lambda expression ends right there. So we'll see what Java does in this situation. We get a no such element exception, as you can see here. It would be nice if we could figure this out at compile time, but I'm not seeing an easy way to do that because, at least in my example, you could pretty easily tell that we're not having an active binding for this thread right here. But let's say that you've got a method that's 10 or 12 layers deep and it could be called via a dozen different methods, right? How do I know if I have a binding open or not? I don't think the compiler could necessarily determine that for us. But at runtime, you can ask the current thread if it has a binding associated with it with the isBound method. And what this will do is basically it will say, hey, if I have a binding, then I can go ahead and get the value from it. If I don't have a binding, then I probably either should add a binding or I should bail out because I expect the scoped value to have something and it doesn't have anything. You could then wrap that in an if clause and then do some conditional logic based off of that. All in all, it'll be interesting to see where scoped values go. I think they'd be cool to add to the language, and in JDK 22, there weren't any changes from JDK 21 where the first preview happened. So I guess we'll see what happens in JDK 23. Thank you for watching today's video. I hope you liked it. If you did, please do smash that like button. Take a moment to subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. I'd really appreciate it. Thanks again for watching. I hope you have a good rest of your day, and I hope to see you next time. Take care.